Good morning. Welcome, everybody. Thank you for coming out this morning. It's so nice to see a great crowd here today. I'm Mallory Shelton, and I'm with the Naval Aviation Museum Foundation. And this is our Discovery Saturday program, and I see a lot of new faces in the crowd. So just a little bit about the program. Discovery Saturday was started several years ago as a program on behalf of the foundation to really educate and inspire the community about naval aviation history. So we thought that it was the perfect opportunity to invite Kevin and his wife Lindsay out today to really share his story and to also talk about his new book, The Last Punisher. And I think a lot of you guys here today have probably read the book already and can agree with me when I say that it touches really on so many different things, aside from people that have been involved in the military, but I think just life in general. So it talks about life struggles and making mistakes. It talks about that even as a Navy SEAL who is expected to be precise in everything that they do, that they too make mistakes. And lastly, it talks about heroism of the men and women who lay their lives on the line for us today, about the brotherhood and the bonds that are created during that time, and really overall just the amazing war stories that he can share with us today. So I'm not going to take up too much of your time because I know you guys want to hear from Kevin, but I do want to tell you guys just a little bit about him. Kevin Lacz was born and raised in Connecticut before joining the Navy in 2002. He graduated BUDS Class 246 and did two platoons at SEAL Team 3 as a platoon sniper, breacher, and combat medic, each with a deployment in Iraq in 2006 and 2008. Upon completing his enlistment, Kevin was honorably discharged from the Navy. He was awarded a number of commendations for his service, including a Bronze Star with a Combat V. When he left the Navy in 2009, he enrolled at UConn, where he completed a degree in political science. He then enrolled at Wake Forest University, where he finished a master's in medical sciences as a physician assistant. Currently, Kevin works as a physician assistant and lives in Gulf Breeze with his wife, Lindsay, and their two young children. Kevin also served as a technical advisor and played himself in Clint Eastwood's Oscar-nominated film, American Sniper. As SEAL technical advisor on Clint Eastwood's film, Kevin helped the actors accurately portray Navy SEALs, teaching them to mimic the laser-like focus and steadfast determination that were rigorously ingrained in Kevin and Chris Kyle as members of the country's most elite Special Ops Command Force. Kevin's past military service influences him greatly as he seeks to actively support members and veterans in our very own community today. So ladies and gentlemen, I give you Kevin Dauber Lacz.
Thanks, Mallory. Thanks, guys. I'm going to be asking for some volunteers, so Clark, you guys, Gage, be ready to come on up when I call for it. So thanks for coming out today. You know, it's a real honor to be here. I'm always amazed when, you know, people show up to listen to me speak. I'm just an enlisted guy. That's all I was. But it's cool to tell the story and to be able to talk about the experiences that I had. So thank you guys for taking a part of your Saturday to come out and listen to this. Thank you to all the veterans in the crowd. As I look around, I see some veterans, I see the active duty, and it's great to look on and realize that, you know, people are going to go ahead and take up the fight long after we're gone, and, you know, look at these brave men and women to go ahead and do that. So thank you guys for your service. I do want to thank the Air Museum for hosting me today. This is actually the second time I've been here, so apparently the first time wasn't too bad, so they invited me back for a second one. So thank you. I'll try and keep it civil so you bring me back for maybe a third. I do want to thank my buddy Steve Granger, he's not here right now. He works over at the Restoration Project. He's a former SEAL and gave us the behind the scenes tour and kind of set this up and got me hooked up with Mallory. So thanks, Steve. I know you're not here, but I'm sure you hear this. Okay, so I guess you can't really have a combat veteran up here without talking about a war story, right? You got to have at least one war story to get things started, correct? All right, who's heard a great war story? There's one person's heard a great war story. Two. Have you guys ever like hung out at a V3? You ever hung out at a VFW? Right? Or like American Foreign Legion? You know what I mean? You heard a great war story there. How does every single war story start? Hey man, buy me a beer. No, it starts with, no lie, there I was, knee deep in grenade pins, surrounded by the enemy. Right? Basically, that's how every single war story should start or does start, right? So I do have to tell you guys a war story. So no lie, there I was, knee deep in textbooks, surrounded by stress. Not the typical war story you guys would expect to hear, but it was about 2009, 2010, and I was finishing up school. I was at the University of Connecticut. My wife had asked me to go ahead and do a talk kind of like this to her students in high school. And let me tell you something. She's like, hey, can you talk to my students about Veterans Day and what it means to, you know, serve and, you know, that sort of thing? And I was like, instantly, like the panic button hit me. I was like, one, I hope I'm not going to cuss in front of all these like young impressionable minds. I just got out of the Navy. Two, I'm like, what am I going to talk about? And she's like, just talk about your life and your experiences and educate these kids on what it's like to do something different. So I made a slideshow kind of like this, and I went into my training, right? I went back to my preparation, you know, stuff that we do as SEALs, as medics, and, you know, I went back to diving, right? I studied Boyle's Law a little bit to learn about partial pressure and diving. I went back to my sniper training to learn about, like, distance and, like, thermoclines and, you know, elevation and windage. I went back to medicine, right? Learning to do chest tubes and needle decompressions and all that fun stuff. And I put together a slideshow. And I had some Scott Evan videos. I get up there and I start talking to these young people. And as I start talking, there's a gentleman in the first row. And he immediately starts like bouncing out of his chair, like as soon as I started talking. Anybody in medicine? Anybody know? All right, medicine. You guys heard of like ICD-10 codes? You know what those are, right? There's a one for this kid. It's called Ants in the Pants, right? He's in the front row and he's like jumping out of his seat. And he's distracting. All right, we got people mimicking it right now. So I go through my speech, which is probably about like 40 minutes long. And, you know, I was reading from note cards and doing all that stuff. It was my first speech. Don't hold anything against me. And at the end, I show them skydiving videos, a bunch of us grouping. So we jump out of the airplane together, you know, link up and, you know, do that formation, fly and then break off and all that stuff. And he couldn't take it anymore. I finished that. He jumps up and he puts his hand up in the air. And I call on him and I'm like, yes. And he goes to me, did you make it? First public speaking, first question, did you make it? I was like, no, death was horrible, but the afterlife is amazing. Wait for it. Funny question, right? Talk about curveball. I did not even see that one coming. I expected, like, is it hot in Iraq? You know, those sort of, the basic stuff. Did you make it? So I guess the question really wasn't as literal as he wanted to be. You know, I was back at school. I'd gotten out of the Navy. I'd done all that cool stuff. And there I was back at school, kind of, you know, about 5 miles an hour. I was at a million miles an hour 4 months prior in Iraq, and now I'm back at school, and life was totally different. And the question really was a reflection of where was I going, right? And to be clear, there were points in time where I didn't know if I was going to make it. Meaning, I didn't know if I was going to be as good outside the Navy as I was in the Navy. And you guys are going to see pictures of all this stuff. That's a terrible push-up form right there, so don't. I'll tell you my mistakes. But I didn't know if I was going to be as good as I was outside the Navy as I was in. But I began to rely on certain things that I had learned. Certain, I guess, themes, really, that became apparent when I went through BUDS or when I got out and went to medic training or sniper school or when I got to Iraq and deployed. And each of us have those qualities. You just need to find them. And I just went through a bunch of different schools to find them, right? I was a knucklehead college student, and then I joined the Navy, and things changed. So where does this story begin? Who's read the book? Awesome. I still haven't read it yet. My wife wrote it. It's amazing. No, I'm just kidding. You know, that book was awesome. We got to work together with Ethan Rocky, and got to dive into the details. You know, Lindsay, my wife Lindsay over there in blue, she always knew the stories and always asked the questions, and whenever she asked a question, I would answer it. But with the book, I had to answer everything. So we got the details, and thanks for reading it. I hope you guys liked it. So where does everything begin? Well, I'm from Connecticut. I grew up in middle-class family. I have two younger brothers. I did everything that, you know, kids in Connecticut do, right? I had a Jeep Grand Cherokee Laredo. You know, I played golf, did swimming. We didn't have a membership down at the sailing club. I'm just kidding, right? I'm reinforcing the stereotypes of Connecticut. But I did everything you typically do in Connecticut. And I went to high school. I went to an all-guys Catholic prep school. And I wanted to be the first kid in my family to go to a four-year school. I wanted to become a doctor. Both my mom and dad went to two-year schools. And I did well in high school, National Honor Society, and I took the next step, which was go to James Madison University. Has anyone heard of JMU? All right, down in Harrisonburg, Virginia. I was really excited about that. Well, when I got there, I enjoyed college. Who enjoyed college? Yeah, who really enjoyed college? Yeah, all right. Who joined the Navy after that experience? That's what I did. So when I got to school, I excelled in everything. I excelled in rugby. I excelled in beer pong. I excelled in like scrapping with, you know, frat boys. What I did not excel in was going to class. That's a problem when your parents are shelling out a bunch of money for you in your higher education. So after my first semester, I had a GPA that was bad, like real bad. Any baseball fans out here? Yeah, okay. So what was Nolan Ryan's ERA in 1981? Come on, you guys said you're fans, right? 1.69. Pretty admirable if you're a pitcher, major league. Not when you're a college student, right? My GPA was a 0.7 after my first semester. Yeah. Yeah, you know how it went over when I told my parents what my GPA was? Who's a Florida State fan? All right, who's a Gator fan? All right, there's more Florida State, so I guess this one works. So, you know, you grow up and, you know, you're a Florida State fan and you've got like a Bobby Bowden shrine in your house and, you know, you guys can do the song. The ringtone is the song on your cell phone, you know, the seminal song. And your daughter comes home with her first boyfriend. And he's got Gators gear on, right? You know that look right there, that sheer terror? That's the look that my parents had when they saw my transcript from my first semester. They didn't think it was funny. Neither did I. It was kind of a shock to actually fail so miserably. I didn't think, you know, I could really do that poorly, but, you know, leave it to myself to outdo myself. And I thought maybe I could do better. So I took it as, it wasn't a failure, it was merely a time to tell my parents that, you know, this is a lesson learned. I'm not going to make this mistake again. And my parents bought it, hook, line, and sinker. And they anteed up for another semester. And my GPA kind of tracked up a little bit higher, just a little bit, like in the ones. And then I had to do another semester, a summer semester, and it trickled up a little bit more. And by the end of three semesters and a full year at James Madison, according to the Dean of Academic Affairs, I was still a freshman. I was like half a freshman. I didn't even finish a whole year. So I took another semester. And in the fall of 2001, I was failing just as bad as I was like the first semester. And something changed, right? Something that anybody over the age of 15 in this audience changed their life. And it was 9/11. And I wish I could tell you I woke up one morning and I was like, you know, I was ready to do something. But I woke up in a haze because I was partying the night before. Shocker. All right, I'm upfront and honest. And I woke up and I remember walking to my computer and turning on AOL Instant Messenger and looking at the ticker that said the trade centers had crumbled. And I was like, wow, stock market crashed. Like, I wasn't very smart back then. I'm still not very smart. And my mom calls me up and she's like, our friend Bruce Eagleson was in the Trade Center. He'd come down and made a phone call to his kids and then had gone back up to attend to the rest of the people in his office, and they had never heard from him again. And she's like, pray for him. So I sat that day and I knew something was changing. Obviously, you know, you look at the TVs, you see you know, that visceral, like, what's going on after 9/11. But I knew something down deep had changed. A few months later, I went to a memorial service where there was no closure for Bruce, and then going back to school wasn't an option. I wasn't doing that great. Really wasn't excelling at anything. Rugby, I was pretty good. But I needed to change my life. I was going in this direction, and it was bad. And I went down to the recruiting office. I wanted to be in the military. I always had an appreciation for the military. I didn't know what I was going to do. So I went down to the Marines. Who's a Marine? All right. So I walked down to the office, and I wanted to be the few, the proud. And they were out to lunch. No lie, the Marine recruiter was out to lunch. You know that sign that says, gone fishing, be back at 1300? Was not there. I always ask how many Marines in the crowd, because if I'm outnumbered, I don't tell that story. But literally, I went to the Navy office, and I saw a poster of a bunch of guys crawling out of the water with mustaches, big old handlebar mustaches and face paint. I had peach fuzz on my face. I was like, I want to do that. The recruiter looks at me, he's like, yeah, buddy, it's a little bit harder than you think. I was like, no, I want to do that. So at that moment, I made that decision. I'm going to change where I'm going, and I want to be a SEAL. I never grew up wanting to be a SEAL. Literally saw a poster. That's all it was. And I knew I wanted to jump out of airplanes, and I wanted to go shoot bad guys. I knew what happened after 9/11. I wanted to go ahead and shoot bad guys. So you guys think the next step was just, hey, Micah, how's it going, man? Good to see you. The next step was, Micah and I were over at the team together. The next step wasn't just you become a SEAL. It becomes a process of really relearning yourself, understanding those qualities that we all have, but just tapping into them. So I joined the Navy. I went to Great Lakes. And then from there, I went to Hospital Corpsman School, where I learned how to be a basic Navy medic. Learned about IVs, learned about, you know, sick call, learned about all that fun stuff. And then I went to BUDS, Basic Underwater Demolition SEAL Training. All right, where are my volunteers? Gage, Taylor, come here, guys, I need three. So then I went to BUDS, and there's three different phases, and I learned a lot about myself. You guys see it on TV, you see first phase, second phase, third phase, there's pictures of second phase right there. All right, where are my three volunteers? No, they know the Navy thing, never again volunteer yourself, N-A-V-Y. And I'd classed up with about 200 guys, and I went through first phase first. All right, who's going to wear a helmet? All right, come on, you guys are going to, come on, you're going to be interactive here. All right, so I went to first phase, which is the green helmet, and that's all the physical stuff. And then I went to second phase, which is all the diving stuff. And then third phase is all the land warfare stuff. And it's easy, right? You know? But it's not really that easy. It's like old baseball again. Yogi Berra, half of everything is 99% mental. It doesn't make sense to anybody except for Yogi. But BUDS is all mental. Really, you got to be in physical shape to do it, but it's really how much do you want to do it. For example, there's an exercise in first phase, which is called the 50-meter underwater swim, where you swim underwater for 50 meters. It's actually really easy. You jump in the water, you do a flip underwater, you can't kick off, you have to swim, you know, 25 meters and then swim 25 meters back, and you see it on TV, a lot of people pass out. Well, you do it time and time again, and you know, you practice it, and I'd see people quit right before game day, right before the evolution. Not because they couldn't do the job, they mentally told themselves they couldn't do it. Another, for example, is drown proofing. You guys see it all the time too. On TV, where they tie your feet together, your hands behind your back, and they kick you in the pool, and you have to bob up and down for 10 minutes, and then you have to drop your mask down and pick it up with your teeth, and then keep bobbing up and down, and then you have to swim 100 yards with your hands and feet tied, and then float for 5 minutes. It's not, you'd come over to my pool, we'll practice it, you guys will be pros in a minute. My roommate was awesome. He was a great, I went through boot camp with him. He was a physical anomaly. He had done drown proofing time and time again. But when it came to game day and doing it, he didn't show up. He quit right before it. It's not because he couldn't do it, but he told himself he couldn't do it. And that's BUDS. 80% is above the neck. So it doesn't matter what you do in life, if you tell yourself you're going to do it, you will do it. And we're beginning to learn that time and time again. You guys having fun? Yeah, all right. Stay right there. So we graduated Hell Week, which is the fourth week of first phase, and we started with 101 guys, and we ended up graduating with 39. A lot of them for injuries, but a lot of people who just didn't want to do it. And each time I saw somebody quit, it was reaffirming to my decision to join the Navy. I was like, that person rings out and drops on request. I was like, all right, I'm stronger, I'm faster, I'm tougher than that guy. And you start building off of that. When you see more and more people quit, and you're standing there with your boat crew freezing on Friday morning, and you're shivering, and you know you and your buddies are hanging out, and you're like, we did it. It builds something. It's like armor. It makes you stronger. And that's what Buds is. So after Buds, I went to, all right, you guys can hang out. Or you want to hang out still? All right, you guys can hang out. So after Buds, I went to jump school, where I learned how to jump out of airplanes. All right, why don't you guys put this on? It's a ghillie suit. You want to be a sniper for a day? Who wants to be a sniper? All right, here you go. I got a hat, I got pants, I got a jacket, and I got a hat. You can take the helmets off. You guys are going to try and pick out the sniper in the crowd. And then I went to SEAL qualification training, where I learned how to be a better at my skill sets, how to shoot better, how to drive better, how to dive better, just learn the skills a little bit better, learn how to put on pants correctly. And then I went to 18 Delta, which is a special operations medic school. So I learned off my basic Navy medic stuff, and then from there I learned how to be a special operations paramedic, right? How to be a first responder, how to do chest tubes, venous cutdowns, crikes, how to be hemorrhage control specialist on the battlefield before you get to a CAS station, a hospital, you know, where the surgeons are at. And I learned how to take more responsibility. Like 2 years earlier, I was playing beer pong, drinking beers, and now I'm a first responder for a SEAL unit. And there's a lot of responsibility for that. So it wasn't just me, a kid, trying to play SEAL. It was, there's a job to do. And at that moment, you realize that as a medic, you are responsible for the people in your platoon and their health and well-being. There we go. Hear no evil, see no evil, speak no evil. You guys look good. Thank you. And from there, I went to sniper school. I got to SEAL Team 3, and I learned how to be a sniper, learned how to do that job, right? You guys see it in the movies, you read in the book, how to be accountable for your actions. A lot of people look at snipers and they're like, wow, it's all you do is shoot, right? Not the case. I learned how to be interactive with my environment, how to observe. 90% of a sniper's job is simply to observe your surroundings and be able to articulate that and tell people what it's all about. You learn how to shoot a lot, but the chance to use that skill is very little. I learned how that discipline and how to be accountable for my actions. Because as a sniper, as a pilot about to drop a bomb, you're the last person responsible for that round. And it's heavy, that decision. And I had lots of people in my platoon that, you know, helped me out with that. When I got to SEAL Team 3, I had Chris Kyle, who was a mentor. He had been in Fallujah before I got to SEAL Team 3 and helped show me the ropes. I also had a lot of upper enlisted guys that you read about in the book. Tony, my platoon chief, awesome. Hard as woodpecker lips, that guy. He went through 9 deployments before I got there for my first, so he obviously had been there before. And the crews, and you hear the names. And then we deployed, all right? I talk a lot about deployment in the book. Try to get into detail. Put you under the helmet, put you in the shoes of what it's like to be a brand new sniper, brand new SEAL going into the fever pitch of the Iraq War. And it's fun. It's fun as a SEAL when you get to exercise your skill set. You join for a reason. You don't join not to get a ghillie suit issued or wear a trident, but you join to exercise your skill set that you train so hard to learn. And I enjoyed it. I enjoyed doing the job, but also building the camaraderie. And that's really the biggest thing with the book that we tried to do. And I know everybody that's worn the uniform has worn the flag and represented it knows what it is to be a part of the brotherhood and what it means. And you learn those situations because, any basketball fans out there? Yeah, so Dwayne Wade, you know who he is? Yeah, basketball player. The best thing Dwayne Wade ever said, besides LeBron, don't leave for Cleveland, was no team works out teamwork. I talk to a lot of companies and they're always like, how do you get better as a team? I'm like, well, you don't put it on the schedule that we're going to work out teamwork. You spend time together and you do things together. And what makes a team strong, which made our team strong, our platoon strong, is the amount of time spent doing your job. And that's the only way you get better. And in Iraq, we did it every single day. And that bond becomes stronger and stronger and stronger. I'm not going to talk too much about deployment. You'll read about that. You guys hot and sweaty yet? You over it? It's heavy? Oh, man. It's heavy? I was going to put the body armor and helmets on you guys, too. So people always ask me, they're like, what's the hardest thing you ever did in the Navy? What's the hardest thing? Getting out of the Navy. Leaving it all behind. I see a lot of heads nodding out there. You know exactly what I'm talking about. So I talk about the brotherhood, and I talk about the teams and the camaraderie, and then leaving it. So I did two deployments to Iraq, one in 2006, one in 2008, and then I got out. And the decision was to continue on in the medical field. I wanted to become a physician assistant. I worked a lot with PAs overseas. I got to see how awesome they were, how calm under pressure they are, and how efficient their training is. 2-year master program, done. So I got out and I went to UConn and I went to Wake Forest. But I left the teams behind. And it's not something you can just walk away from easily and say, all right, see you later. Nice knowing you guys. It's something that always sticks with you. It's like fingerprints on your background, right? They're always with you. And those experiences we have in the teams with the people that we care so much about have a lasting impression. And I found the hardest thing about leaving the teams was, no matter what job I walk into, if there's a bullet coming towards me, I'm never going to have like 10 to 15 guys willing to jump in front of it before it hits me outside the SEAL teams. Right? A lot of head nods. And that's absolutely correct. Leaving that all behind is hard to do. But the skill sets that you learned in the Navy, or the Army, the Air Force, the Marines, Coast Guard, and the impressions that the people that you worked with in that brotherhood makes you better. Like, I found out a lot about myself after August 2nd. Those of you that read the book know exactly what I'm talking about. I learned a lot about what I was capable of as a sniper. And stuff that I learned from Chris. I learned how to be a better human being from Mark and Biggles. You guys will read about that. I learned how to be tougher from meeting those guys and working with those guys. And it lent credit to what I was able to do. Undergrad was, man, it was like Billy Madison, where you go back to school and Billy's in like fourth grade with all the fourth graders. You know what I'm talking about. Everyone's all like immature, and I just got back from war. But then I went to PA school, which master's program at Wake Forest is like mental buds, right? Basic underwater demolition SEAL training, one of the hardest things I ever did, but mentally, right? That's where I put things to use. 3-meter targets and 10-meter targets. You have two targets presented, one at 3 meters, one at 10 meters. I learned how to engage the first target first and then move on to the second one. It's a basic skill you learn in war, but when you apply it to your everyday life, it makes things easier. Like, there are things right in front of you that need to get done. Once you finish those, you can look at the second one. And I was able to rinse and repeat and replicate in PA school. Who's seen American Sniper? All right. I said that once in Texas. I was like, hey, who's seen American Sniper? They all looked at me like I was going to get beat up. So somewhere during PA school, I was working actually, let me back it up. So I was at PA school, and I showed up early, and my wife was finishing her semester teaching up in Connecticut. And I had to move everything down there and get everything set up and start school, and she would come down a couple months later. So I'm all in my battle rhythm, you know, going through PA school, and Lindsay shows up. What I didn't know when I left her up in Connecticut as a Spartan wife, I left her with a house, an air mattress, a kid, and a laptop. You know, very Spartan-esque, right? I didn't know that Bradley Cooper's production company had bought the rights to American Sniper. And I didn't know that she had sent a message to the screenwriter who was listed in that article as Jason Hall and sent him a message on Facebook that said, "Hey, dude, don't mess this story up. There's a lot of important people." So when Lindsay showed up in Winston-Salem and we were having coffee one morning and she's like, "Hey, I've got to tell you something." Didn't really strike me as anything weird. She's like, "I met a guy." Spidey senses on. Dauber crush. She's like, no, he's an actor. He's from Hollywood. And I was like, all right, I'm really going to lump this guy up. She's like, "No, I talked to the screenwriter from American Sniper." And I was like, oh. She's like, "He wants to hear more about Biggles and Mark Lee and about your platoon." So I text Chris, and Chris was alive at the time, and told him, and I was working with his company, Kraft. Chris was like, "Yeah, he's Hollywood, man, but let's go with it." So for the next 4 months, Chris and Jason and I worked on American Sniper. And you guys know the rest of the history in February 2nd. But Jason had asked me if I'd work on the movie as a technical advisor in that capacity. And I didn't know what I was getting myself into. I'll save you all the details. You guys have seen the movie. I auditioned, played myself in the movie. But I learned to work with other people. You guys are like, "Really? Come on, you're in healthcare, you know, work with other people." But I learned how to work with groups of people that I probably would never have interacted with had I not worked in Hollywood. And how did I do that? Well, I went back to Navy training. When you're on deployment as a SEAL, you work with everybody, Marines, Army, Air Force, you name it. That interoperability makes you dynamic. And when you're dynamic, you get employed. And when you get employed, you can exercise your skill set, right? So I learned how to work with people from Hollywood, which you never really get what you want, but you learn how to deal and negotiate and work together to come up with a product. And that was one of the hardest things I'd ever done. Work with Hollywood people, production companies, writers, producers. But it was rewarding. And the product is a representative of the combination, people coming together and making it happen. It was really special. So what do I do now? I'm a physician assistant. I work with people. Same thing I did in the teams, like Micah back there, work with patients. And I love working with people. Started very early on in my career with as a corpsman, as a special operations medic. But I take those skills that I learned on deployment in the Navy, and they don't stay packed in a little box. Like Mallory said, "Hey, Discovery Saturday." And I didn't realize what that meant. It was literally discover how much dust and smelly gear you have in cruise boxes still in your garage. And I pulled it all out for you guys to waft and smell today. Scratch and sniff day. All right, you guys are still with me. All right, cool. But those experiences shouldn't stay locked up in a box. As a veteran, we shouldn't just take our experiences and tuck them away. Why? Well, disproportionately, less and less people serve this country. And more people consume the news. And they have no idea what goes on in between and what people do overseas and why we do it. When they're looking to make their businesses better, they look for veterans. Why? Because you can ensure mission success. You can change your battlefield. You've done it overseas. So don't lock all those experiences up. Show people what you're worth and what you can do. And you truly can make your team better. You can change that battlefield. You can definitely win. So with the book, with what we do now, it's we take our experiences and we use them to go forward. We use them to change. We use them to make the people around us better. And ultimately, we all win together. Thank you, guys.
Come on, that's fine.
Goodbye.
Yeah, you guys can take it off.
Awesome. Does anyone have any questions? Yes, ma'am.
The photographs in your book, some of the faces are whatever.
blurred out? Yeah. So the question is, so some of the photographs in the book, why are some of the faces blurred out? Some of the guys are active duty still, so to protect their identity, we blurred out their faces. Most of the gentlemen in the book, I either use their real name or their nickname, or if they're with a certain unit, I just change their name altogether to protect their identity. Yes, sir.
Could you comment on the rules of engagement? I heard they're different for Army, Marine, SEAL, Special Ops.
Sure. The question is about rules of engagement. Well, those things are changing all the time, kind of like the West Wind. And it really depends. What I know is what I experienced. And I experienced war back in 2006 through 2008 period. And the rules of engagement changed, you know, from the first time I was there versus the second time. And it really depends about the delicate social geopolitical climate. And for us, when I was over there, our rules of engagement were pretty liberal. Where Ramadi was and how high the threat was and how high the coalition casualty rates were, we had pretty, I would say carte blanche, but we definitely were able to utilize our skill sets more so than when I went back in 2008. But it really is situationally dependent, and I know it's changed quite a bit to where we are at the present and what our servicemen are able to do, you know, in their capacities and around the globe. I know that really doesn't answer your question, but it changes. And back when I first got over there, we were able to do a lot of what we wanted.
Do they ever frustrate you?
You know, there's a threat's a threat. So you always get to, you know, there's a bad guy with a gun, and that's a bad guy with a gun. It really doesn't involve any thinking. But, you know, it's a chess game, right? You can't just assume somebody's bad. You have to give them the benefit of the doubt until their action warrants, you know, more critical thinking and more definitive action. It's frustrating when, you know, people get injured or killed when you really want to use preemptive strikes and really take care of business, and that's where it's frustrating.
Over here. Well, first of all, thank you for coming to visit with us again. When was it you were here before?
I was here in May last year with Nick Irving for the Sniper Showcase.
Yeah. You shared the stage with Nicholas, and he'd written a book called The Reaper. Is that right?
Yes.
And then he was supposed to go to Hollywood and make a movie. Did that ever happen?
I think it's a TV series with NBC. I think they're working on it currently.
Well, the question is, what's the primary differences between him, you know, as a Ranger and you as a SEAL?
We swim a whole lot better than Rangers. Truth. Rangers and what they do, there's not a ton of variance, you know, and like I said, you know, things changed, and when I got out in 2010, you know, the SEAL missions changed. We've returned a lot more to maritime operations, still working a lot on the ground, but, you know, Rangers have evolved from seizing, holding airfields to working in support of and with, you know, Tier 1 units. But ultimately, you know, we both work at the front end, you know, in that fight against evil. Yes. I didn't get that. He worked with his Ranger element. You know, I don't know if he worked alone. Yeah, when you go out there, you always want at least one person with you. And if you're going into a fight, bring your buddies. If you're going into a big fight, bring a lot of your buddies and a lot of awesome guns. Yes, sir.
When you were involved with the movie, did you have bad experiences while you were over in Iraq? Did they sort of like haunt you when you were making the movie, or was it a good experience for you to make the movie?
Yeah, so the question was the movie, and did you have any bad experiences in Iraq that kind of were triggered during the movie, the production of the movie? No, across the board. And one of the things with The Last Punisher that we wanted to do was talk about the mindset. Any readers of Lieutenant Colonel Dave Grossman on Killing, he talks about the sheepdog theory, and we wanted to go ahead and illustrate that in the book, where, you know, my feedback with American Sniper, and this is, you know, what I've been saying, and this is really how I feel, was a lot of people have said, thanks for your service, after seeing American Sniper. But I had people say, I'm sorry you had to go through that. You know, people are like the sympathy, and I'm kind of like scratched my head. Like, you know, I wanted to join the Navy. You know, I joined in response to 9/11. I don't need any sympathy. And I feel that, and what we wanted to do with this book was to help decipher between, you know, the two. I enjoy doing what I did. And I feel we do a disservice to people when we assume that war changes you for the negative. And war changes you just like if you drive down the road and you see a traumatic accident. That's going to change you, no doubt. But to assume that everybody that goes down range comes back fragile or broken is a disservice to those who have PTSD, and also a disservice to those that don't have PTSD. And I think it's important to make that difference. And what we want to do with the book is talk about that. So did the movie trigger anything? No, I mean, you know, you do a scene and there's like fake stuff all around and then they're like cut and then everybody goes eats and surf and turf for lunch, you know, a little bit different than war. With Clint, you know, the gravelly voice kind of puts you back in the moment. No experiences. And I think it's important, you know, when you tell your story as a veteran to make that difference, you know, and help re-educate people that assume that every experience is negative and it hurts you. Yes, sir.
I've seen a film clip of a sniper online that used a 50 caliber rifle for extremely long distance. What is the weapon of choice, or is it a individual choice that you make as to what weapon you would like to use?
The question is about weapons and weapon selection. Usually the team or the unit has a collection of weapons that they utilize from all different types of platforms, from close quarters combat to, you know, obviously your secondary weapons, pistols, to our sniper suite. And as snipers, we had a bunch of different, we had the 50 caliber sniper rifle, which none of us used or carried because it was so darn heavy. And when you're in 120, 130 degree heat, the last thing you want to do is be carrying around a 30 pound weapon and the giant rounds that it shoots. We preferred a little lighter, hotter, faster rounds, like 300 Win Mag, with stuff that, you know, what's that? 30 caliber, 300 Win Mag. 300 Win Mag, yes. Remington 700, your simple over-the-counter Walmart gun. But I really like the Mark 11, which is a semi-automatic sniper rifle with suppressor on it, because you can patrol with it and then get up to a hide side, put the suppressor on, and instead of carrying two guns. But it really depends on the unit, and those are all predetermined. Can't bring your own 30-06 out on deployment. Yes, ma'am. No. Those are like, they regulate that stuff.
Kevin, how did you pick the title for your book?
That's a great question. So I'm not the last Punisher. There's a lot of Punishers out there living, breathing, walking the earth, doing great things. So when you read the book, you know, you definitely get the impression, I hope you all do, about the people who've given the ultimate sacrifice. And Ryan Jobe was injured and eventually died post-operatively in 2009. Mark Lee was killed in August 2006, and Mike Monsoor in September. And those guys are the last of the Punishers, because after that, we really didn't use the Punisher thing anymore. It was kind of like, that's it. It stays right there. So those guys are the last of the Punishers. And, you know, the publishing house definitely wanted to use that title, too. Yes, sir.
Your faith. Pre-service, service, post-service. How did you find that, you know, throughout all this?
Great question. You know, when I was deployed, I grew up Catholic. Went to Catholic school, parochial school, all the way up to 12th grade. And then, you know, went to college. There wasn't much faith in college. Faith in myself, faith in anything else. And when I deployed and got through the teams, I mean, I carried a rosary, but it wasn't something that I, you know, spent a lot of time. I was young. There were people in my platoon, like Mark Lee, who put a lot more in, and I was willing to have conversations with him freely about faith. Really, it stayed the same up until last year, really, when I went to Israel. And I got to experience it and really dive a little bit deeper. And, And going back and looking at those experiences in faith and putting it through that lens, bad people are still bad people, and I'm okay with that. And that'll never change. And, you know, if you're a man of faith, woman of faith, you believe in, you know, compassion, you believe in the goodness in other people. And what we describe in the book and what people describe when you go down range is just pure evil. So actions are justified and faith never really changes.
Both from a combat zone standpoint, but also from when you're coming off deployment, from a support standpoint, what are some groups or folks that help our guys and ladies overseas, but also help their families here that you all were able to interface with?
I really didn't have much of anything back then. You know, our decompression stops, which is what they were called, leaving a combat zone, was stop in Germany for 48 hours, drink your face off, and then fly back to San Diego. And that's what it was. Now they've integrated a lot more. I know the team, you know, there's other people that could speak to that. The team works to bring more of the family component and reintegrate, you know, the spouse back into the family unit, incorporate the family. They do trips to Disney World. They put on talks. And that's important. I didn't have any of that, and I probably really didn't need any of that because I was a single guy, you know, met my wife after my first deployment. So wasn't really room for me, but there's a lot more attention put to that because it's in a community like the SEAL teams or the Ranger battalions, the divorce rate is very high. And it's, you know, one, the type of individual, somebody who's very driven, job focused, that's willing to put everything aside for mission success. So it's important that we are paying closer attention, but it's gotten a lot better than it has in the past. Answer your question? Okay.
Besides your book and American Sniper, would you recommend any other books for the people that haven't been in the service to convey any messages or experiences?
Now you guys should just buy The Last Punisher and that's it.
In addition to
some good addendums. So I really liked, so when it came to writing this book and juxtaposing two different styles, I really like Eugene Sledge's book, With the Old Breed, classic book. And I really like that day-to-day. He's a Mobile guy too. And I like the humility of George Bush's decision points. And how he was able to talk about tough things. And we talk about battle fatigue, and we talk about in this book what it's like to run, and then things happen. The wheels come off the bus. So I liked his approach and I like that. Book-wise, I mean, it really, if you're looking for a very technical approach to SEAL training, I enjoyed Dick Couch's The Warrior Elite, The Forging of Buds Class 228. I think it's 228. When it comes to other books, I've got a couple good ones that I have to read, but Eugene Sledge's With the Old Breed is a classic. It's one of the best.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Did you have a question?
So how did you prepare physically for your pipeline?
Kind of, you know, I did the basics. Now they're producing athletes that are just bigger, stronger, faster, and they train a lot smarter. You know, back then it was kind of like that old Planet Fitness commercial. I pick things up, I put them down, you know, just lift heavy weights. But I focused a lot on body weight stuff. So a lot of push-ups, sit-ups, swim, run. I hate running, hated running. When I was in Buds, I always was in the goon squad. Yeah, that's the one that, like, when they're doing timed runs and, like, people running by, they're like, time! I was always, like, that guy that failed. And it was like, get in the surf zone, get wet and sandy, you know, carry the logs a little bit longer, boats. That may be better. Maybe, you know, suffer more, which made Hell Week a little bit more pleasant for me, less for others. But it was a lot of just the stuff that you do in Buds, which is swimming, running, push-ups, sit-ups, pull-ups are a big one.
Sir? Did you have like a pre-kind of mission, like pre-game ritual that you would do before y'all would head out in the field?
I mean, nothing really consistent. In 06, it was usually a bunch of rippets. If you guys have deployed, you know what rippets are. So a bunch of rippets, which are like grade F, like energy drinks. It's nothing but sugar, some Slayer, and then just once you get in the trucks, it's just calm. Just shut everything off. Yes?
I'm curious. As a veteran, I feel like I've seen so few movies that really do represent the reality of the military. How did you feel as an advisor? Do you feel like you were able to really get that across when you were working on American Sniper?
Like I said, it's a collaborative effort. No, you know, I went in thinking it was going to be a very realistic representation, kind of like Ridley Scott's Black Hawk Down was, just that war component. And then when you were working with Bradley wanted to be more of a character study of Chris Kyle, to convey more of a storytelling emotion, you know, almost like the hero's journey, the almost like the tragic arc, like artistic. So that threw me for a loop, okay? Art, you know, not me. So working with him on that, I tried to interject as much realism as I could. Obviously, you know, the fact that Chris is out there putting on his own little unit to go hunt one bad guy, and most people are like, well, there's like a commanding officer and then you have an opso, and then all this, I was like, you're not gonna get that point across in a 2-hour movie. So yeah, there are details that are missed. And that's why I really feel that if you're going to understand what it's like to be overseas, you shouldn't get your fix from just Hollywood. You have to listen to veterans, you have to listen to these first person stories of what it's like to be there, because they're just simply playing a real life hero like Chris, or you know, like Marcus Luttrell, or you know, Nick Irving. You want to hear from those people, because those people are going to tell it to you no holds bar, and you know, convey the truth versus a lens. Yes.
Sir, I'm just curious, as a sniper, what's the pre-game thought it goes through your head when you make that ultimate trigger pull, and what's the thought goes through as an aftermath?
That's a great question. You know, you're constantly, and go back to rules of engagement, you're working through your rules of engagement constantly. You know, calmness is contagious, and you know, the more, when you're working at distance, you know, you have to be calm as a cucumber. Cool as a cucumber. But you know, you're looking to make sure at every single moment, every single, up until the point that you squeeze the trigger, that is justified. And that goes with anything you do, whether it's you know, sniper, or you know, clearing houses, or if you're a pilot, you know, about to drop an airstrike. You have to make sure that that's justified, because what sets us apart from the bad guys is we are civil people. You know, we are a cultured society, and what we do is we discriminate. These are bad people. We just don't indiscriminately harm people. You know, we make sure that this round is for a bad person, not a bad person only. And that's what makes us thinking shooters, and that's what makes us professional. So always following in those rules of engagement, and just being really situationally aware of the environment you're in.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take one more question. You'll be the last one, and then we are going to proceed with a book signing. But first, after the question, or the question here, we're going to start the lineup on this side of the stage, for those of you who have books. But sir, go ahead with your question.
Good question. Did I screen for Green Team? No, I did my 2 deployments, and Lindsay will tell you that was kind of the thing. It was either get out, go to PA school, or screen, and I never screened.
Thank you very much, Kevin, for being here. Let's give him a huge round of applause.
You guys have fun? All right.
Thank you all for being here. And if you want to go ahead and start lining up, we'll start the signing and you can move through the line.